Good morning, church. Let's stand this morning as we open our service with the reading of God's Word. This comes from Psalm 150. Verse 1. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty pharaoh. Praise Him for His mighty acts. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise Him with the lute and the harp. Praise Him with the timbrel and dance. Praise Him with stringed instruments and flutes. Praise Him with loud cymbals. Praise Him with clashing cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord this morning. Let's sing it, church. Praise Him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him, highest archangel of glory. Strength and honor give to His holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard His children. In His arms, He carries them all in all. Praise Him, tell His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. Amen. Praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins He suffered and let it die. He our rock, our hope of eternal salvation.
Thank you.
rest on His unchanging grace. In every high stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Class, come on. Christ the Lord. Strong.
great are you, Lord. Lord, may these voices, these instruments just bring you praise and glory. May we humble ourselves before your awesome power and your greatness. Lord, may we feel your spirit move through the service today, God. May you revive us. Revive us with your holy word. May we be that light that we need to be for our neighbors, our loved ones, our families. Bless us, Lord. Bless us indeed. We love you and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Be seated this morning. Before Brother Robert comes, Brother Jerry Austin is going to sing a song.
Can't let it God's word. Now, let me just kind of remind you about something, okay? Rulers, and this is an election year, by the way, and so we appoint these, we vote on these individuals, and they are appointed to protect the innocent, and they are appointed to avenge the oppressed. And so it's a great evil. It's really an atrocity, but it's a great evil when the rulers or the princes, when they themselves become the attackers of the righteous. Are you with me? You understand what I'm saying? That when our elected officials decide that simply because we are a Christian or that we adhere to the Word of God, then we will suffer persecution. My friend, listen, it's coming. It's coming. So you better strap on your boots and you better get in the Word of God, all right? Plain and simple. That the day is coming when even in our own country, our elected officials are going to persecute us simply because we stand in reverence and in awe of the Word of God. Now look though, the psalmist says here, he says, I didn't break your law. I mean, I haven't broken the law. I've not injured you. I've not physically harmed you. I've not even had a desire to injure you. I have not been an advocate of rebellion. I'm not out there rioting in the streets. I'm not living a life of anarchy. I have not openly slandered our elected officials on Facebook. All right, that's what the psalmist is saying. Are you with me? And so he says, I've not done any of that, but simply because I have a respect for God and a respect for God's Word, I am suffering persecution at the hands of the rulers. But because of that, look at what he says here. In verse 161, he says, my heart stands in awe of your Word. How could he stand? How can the psalmist stand up under such powerful oppression or pressure coming to him from these powerful people? Well, he says there, his heart stood in awe of God's Word. That word awe there, it means that he shivered, okay? I mean, it means that he trembled. It's a terror, to be terrified. And so simply put, he just kind of stops and he says, listen, I'm not afraid of what man might do to me. I have a more awe and a reverence of God, our Creator, and His Word that He has given us. Look at verse 162. He says, I rejoice at your Word as one who finds great treasure. You understand that the Bible, that there is a great treasure here that we should not lose. And the psalmist, he says, I am in awe of God's Word. I am not afraid of anyone else. I'm not going to be overcome by fear of these princes or these rulers. But listen though, he says, I am swayed and I am in awe of God's Word. Listen, that is our true freedom. Our true freedom is found in Christ Jesus. That there is forgiveness and there is freedom that is available to all of us. Now look at verse 162. When he has a respect for the Word of God that he mentions in verse 161, that respect or that awe of God's Word leads to a rejoicing. That's why I wanted you to write those two words down, all right? They go hand in hand. I thought about this song and he gives me a hard time. Did y'all know he gives me a hard time? Y'all didn't understand that. You should have said amen there. Did y'all know he gives me a hard time? Amen. Okay, thank you. At least one person understands that. So I almost wanted to text him yesterday and say, brother, I got a song request for today. And because I know he's going to know the song. It's kind of an older song. And it just stuck in my head. The more that I read verse 161 about how the psalmist says that he stands in awe of God's Word. You understand what he said? Where he says his heart stands in awe of God's Word. Now, I don't know how your heart stands in awe. I'm standing physically, though, right? You stand on your feet, don't you, okay? But there was a song that came out a few years ago. I think it was Phillips, Craig, and Dean. You remember them? And the song says, I stand in awe. I stand in awe of you. You know how hard it is in our day and age to stand in all of God's presence? You know why? Because we're so busy with everything else. I mean, it takes you personally to just kind of get in a prayer closet or to get away and turn the phone off and get away from everyone else and listen, and just to get away and be alone with God and just get in tune with God, and then you will stand in all of God. God's going to speak to you. You're going to be in His almighty presence. You're going to get in touch with Him. And then listen, then you're going to praise Him. He says there in verse 162, I rejoice at your word. The respect of the word elicits rejoicing in the word. The verb tense here, it indicates that it is it's a constant, or in other words, a habitual rejoicing. The psalmist didn't say, I went to church on Sunday and got my praise on. That's not what he said. The psalmist is saying, I'm going to praise Him every day. Each and every day. It is a continual or a constant heart of respect and rejoicing. He finds a great treasure. He says there in verse 162. He finds a great treasure in God's Word. And so you understand this? You understand that the Word is the best treasure of all? Amen? I mean, listen, this is better than money in the bank. This is better than all the silver and all the gold. The precious promises that are found in God's Word, this is the greatest treasure. It will never lose its value. No one can ever take from you God's Word. That's why you hide it in your heart. So the question is, do you rejoice at God's Word as someone who has found a great treasure? We ought to. We really ought to. I mean, if we would spend time each and every day in the Word of God and then stand in awe of God's Word and rejoice and praise God, not just for His Word, but what He does and all of that. But listen, then you would understand that you have a great treasure in the palm of your hand and you would praise Him. Think about this. Have you ever thought about this? Have you ever considered how truly blessed that you are knowing that you can hold this right here in your hands and you have it in your own language? Do you understand that there are still people groups, tribes out there in this world that do not have a copy of God's Word in their own language? We're working on it. There are people that are working on it, on translating the Bible into their language. But folks, think about that. We're blessed. And we're so blessed, we don't just have one, we got multiple copies. And not only that, but we have our smartphones where we can get any translation we want at the palm of our fingertips. And so we are truly blessed. It is the greatest treasure. He says there, I rejoice at your word as one who finds a great treasure. Now, look at verse 163. Look at verse 163. And I want you to write these two words down. I want you to write down these two words. I told you to write down respect and rejoice. And I want you to write down these two words. Love and hate. Love and hate. Look at what he says in verse 163. I hate and abhor lying, but I love your law. It's interesting. In one verse, he says, here's what I hate and here's what I love. I hate lying. I hate the evildoers. Listen, the Bible says that if you love the Lord, you're going to hate evil. That makes sense. If you have a love for God and a love for His Word, you're going to hate evil, you're going to hate wickedness, you're going to hate sin. I'm not saying that you hate the sinner, but you hate the sin. And so he loves God's law, but he hated every false way. He contrasts here. The hatred, his hatred for the falsehood, but at the same time, he says, I have a love for God's Word, His law, the direction that He gives me in life. Why? Because he says, this is the greatest treasure. This will never lead me down the wrong path. This is never going to send me in the wrong direction. I can always turn to the Word of God. It's my greatest treasure, and it will be there to lead me and to guide me, and therefore I love it. Now listen, You want to measure? You know, we often like to do this. Well, on a scale of 1 to 10, where would you rate yourself and how much you love God? Listen, I'm going to give you something else, all right? You want to know one measure, one simple measure on how much you truly love God? Here it is. This will tell you how much you truly love God. What are you willing to do to get the greatest treasure into the hands of somebody else? Now, however you answer that will tell you how much you really love God. Think about that for a minute. This is what the psalmist is saying. The psalmist is saying, I stand in awe of God's Word. And I realize that God's Word is the greatest treasure on earth. And therefore, I love God with all my heart, all my mind, all my soul, and all my strength. And I don't want to just keep God's Word to myself. I want somebody else to have God's Word. Are you with me? Shake your head yes. You with me? That's how you can measure how much you truly love God. What are you willing to do in order to get God's Word to somebody else and to share it with others? Well, there's love and hate. And that's part of the constant heart. The constant heart. And number two is this. The constant life. The constant life. I want you to write down these two words. I told you to write down respect and rejoice. Love and hate. But now I want you to write down these two words. Praise and poise. Praise and poise. Alright? Now it gets good now, okay? Look at verse 164. This is my favorite verse in this section. Verse 164, he says this. 7 times a day I went to the refrigerator. Yeah. Hey, amen. Alright. We're Baptists, folks. Alright, come on now. That's not what he said, though, did he? 7 times a day I praise you. Boy, I could camp out here for a while. Because of your righteous judgment. 7, not 7 times a year. Not 7 times a month. Not 7 times a week, because there's 7 days in a week and I'm only going to praise God 1 time a day. No. When he said in verse 162, I rejoice at your word, and now in verse 164, when he says 7 times a day I pray, remember what I said. It is a constant. It is a continual. It is a habitual. It is a lifestyle. In other words, the psalmist says that I have such a love for God's word, it leads to a constant worship and praise life. Reinforces his love for God's direction by praising God often throughout the day. Now, why in the world does he say 7? Well, 7, and I'm just going to throw this in. I talked about this in last Wednesday night's Bible study. And so if you didn't make it last Wednesday night for Bible study, you need to get on YouTube and watch it, all right? And so I talked a little bit about this, but 7 is not the number of perfection. 7 is the number for completion. And there's a difference. So it could be that he is saying, okay, in other words, I constantly and with all of my being, I'm praising you. It's an outpouring of devotion. It's a constant praise and thanksgiving. Why? Because of God's greatest treasure that he's given to us. That God gave us the Word, His divine Word, and it helps lead us to the divine actions in the righteous life that we're called to live. Now think about this for a minute. The devoted Jewish worshiper, the devoted Jewish worshiper would praise or pray, okay? They would pray and praise 3 times a day. Think about that. And the psalmist says 7 times a day. So he's not only doubling, but he's adding another one too. Now don't misunderstand what I'm saying here though. I'm not saying that we need to be legalistic in our praise. the legalistic person in their praise is going to have that checkoff sheet, and they're going to say, okay, starting tomorrow morning, I'm going to get up, and I'm going to praise the Lord, and there's number one, and I'm going to do that six more times today, and by the end of the day, by 10 o'clock tomorrow night, if I don't have those seven done, I'm going to hurry up and get those seven times of praise. That's the legalistic approach to praise. That is not what the psalmist is saying. Are you with me? The spirit-filled worshiper of God says, I'm going to constantly praise God. I'm not going to pout. I'm not going to... By the way, it's hard to be critical. It's hard to criticize the music minister, or it's hard to criticize the preacher if you're just praising God. Amen. It's hard to complain about somebody else in church if you'll pray for them. It's amazing what's going to happen in your life if you just stop being so critical and negative and complaining about anybody and everybody else. If you just start praying for them. Just pray for them. And you find yourself praying for them, you will have a better attitude about them. And then you'll praise God more. I just threw that in. All right. Listen, look at what he said in verse 164. He says, seven times a day I praise you because of your righteous judgment. Verse 165, he says, great peace. Great peace. You notice how he says great peace? Great peace. You know what everybody's needing? Peace with God. Now there's a difference between the peace of God and peace with God. The way that you have peace with God is through Jesus Christ. When you come to faith in Jesus Christ as your first Lord and Savior, then you will have the peace with God then. Modern man. That's what man is searching for. And they long for. Everybody longs for a peace. A peace of mind. Piece of cake. Alright? Here's how we get it. The psalmist says it is very simple. Here's how you get it. You love God. You love God. You love His Word. You rejoice at the fact that you've got the greatest treasure, and then you will have that peace. And not just any kind of peace, but you'll have a great peace in your heart and in your life. The psalmist here, he says that there's a praise, but then there's also a poise. Notice what he says in verse 165. Great peace have those who love your law, and nothing causes them to stumble. That's the poise. In other words, it's okay to praise, but there can't be this arrogant kind of praise. Are you with me? There can't be a haughtiness in your spiritual walk. Why? Because he says there that I don't want to stumble. I don't want to cause others to stumble. I want to walk on a level path. I want to follow God's direction, and I want to experience stability. Because when he said there stumble, that word stumble there means it's a biblical expression of disaster. God, I don't want my life to fall to pieces, to crumble. And I don't want anybody else to either. And so here's what he says. You got to love God's Word. When you love God's Word, sin will depart. Sin, you will flee from sin, and sin will flee from you. You remember that there's an old saying. Sin will keep you from God's Word, and God's Word will keep you from what? Sin. I mean, I didn't come up with that. It's old. It's been around for a while. But it's true, isn't it? I think there's a lot of truth to that. That if you don't find yourself in God's Word, chances are you're finding yourself in sin. But if you find yourself in God's Word, chances are you're not going to be in much sin. But it starts with a love. The psalmist, three times in this section, the psalmist says, I love your law. I have a love for your law. I love your law, your word exceedingly. So there's a praise and a poise from a constant heart and a constant life. And then the third thing is this. There's the constant keeper. The constant keeper. Now, I've told you to write down several words. I told you to write down respect and rejoice. The psalmist says, I have an awe. I stand in awe. Listen, when you understand that you are an unholy person in front of a holy God, a God who loves you no matter what, as Brother Jerry sang about this morning. Listen, folks, I mean that ought to bring some rejoicing to your heart. And you'll stand in awe. There's a respect and rejoice. There's a love and hate. He hates the wicked way. He hates the lying. He hates the falsehood. But he loves what? He loves God's word. The greatest treasure. I told you to write down praise and poise. Praise and poise. And I'm going to give you two more words to write down. I'm done. Walking and waiting. Walking and waiting. Look in verse 166 now. He says, Lord, I hope for your salvation, and I do your commandments. Salvation there is it's an interesting word. We understand what salvation means in the terms of being saved in the sense of going to heaven. And the Bible talks about a blessed hope. There is a blessed hope that we as Christians possess. Non-believers do not have that blessed hope. They're still in the darkness. They're not in the light. But you and I have a hope. And it's a blessed hope for our salvation, our faith, to be made sight. In other words, we all understand that one of these days we're going to leave this earth. And we're going to go home to that place we call heaven, a place of glory, as we call it. And so the psalmist says, though, but look at what he says, though, in verse 166. I'm waiting. I hope for your salvation. I'm waiting, God. Hey, we're waiting for Jesus to come back. Amen? Or we're simply just waiting for the day that we leave this earth to go home. But in the meantime, while we are waiting, we're walking. What do I mean by that? Look at what he says. I do your commandments. What do you mean by that? I do your commandments. In other words, I'm serving. God, I'm doing what you've told me to do while you put me here. While I'm here on this earth, I will be your servant. I'm going to walk in obedience to your word. Because I love your word, it's the greatest treasure in my life. And because of all that, then look now, there's a connection here. Then I'm going to have that great peace that he talked about back in verse 165. When he said, great peace, have those who love your law. You know, there's people today that they're always looking for something new to guide their life. That they've lost sight of God's standard. In other words, what I'm saying is this, they say, well, that Bible, that's out of date. That's a relic. It's ancient history. It's from the past. It doesn't apply to us anymore. Can I just say to that? Yes, it does. The Bible is not a relic. It's not just ancient history. You can take the Word of God and you can apply the commandments, and it's as relevant and as practical as it is today as when God first gave it. So he says, I want to experience, or he expresses his hope for God's salvation. Verse 167, look what he says. My soul keeps your testimonies, and I love them exceedingly. Verse 168, I keep your precepts and your testimonies. Did you notice there twice? There's a repetition. In those last two verses, twice he says, I keep. My soul keeps. And in verse 168, I keep your precepts. There is a repetition here. The writer is telling us, the psalmist is saying, listen, I have a desire to please God by keeping his word, by obeying his precepts. Why? What's the motive? What is the motive for his obedience? Well, look at what he says there. All my ways are what? Before you. Hey, do you understand that this morning? Do you understand that all of your ways are before God? God sees. God knows. You ain't fooling him. sense. The psalmist says there's a deep sense here of being known by God. You know, in other words, you're not just some other, you know, number, right? But that God knows you. It's a total transparency before God. Well, let me wrap this up. Let me ask you this. What would you think? What would you think of an individual, a person, who possessed a priceless treasure, but they treated it as something with such little value? What would you think of it? Well, you'd say, well, they're a fool. I mean, look, they got that $50,000 automobile sitting there in their driveway, and they can put it in the garage. You don't do that, do you? Are you with me, though? Have I got my point across? That this is the greatest treasure? But do we really treasure it? Do we treat this as something that has no value in our life? Sometimes I think we do. Now, I can't answer that question for you. Only you can answer that question for yourself. But do you read the Word on a daily basis? Do you study the Word? I mean, do you open the Word up and say, God, I want you to speak to me? And God, I want to hear from you? I mean, God, your Word is the greatest treasure. But listen, there are those that don't take time to study it or to meditate or even spend just a few minutes a day in the Word of God to hear what the Lord has to say to them. I believe it's evident that the psalmist says, I have a love for your law. God, I have a love for your Word. And that deep love for your Word brings a praise. It brings a rejoicing. And not only that, but then, God, I stand in awe of you. That you are a holy God, and I am such an unholy person. He stood in awe of God and His Word. Listen, I believe that should be true of us. I think it should be true of us. See, it was the case with Job. Listen to this verse over in Job chapter 23. Look, verse 12. Job says this, I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. Job wasn't Baptist, was he? Job says, I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. See, sometimes we get a little grumbling in our tummy, and we immediately want to satisfy that, don't we? I mean, we're not really hungry. We just got a little bit of a hunger. We just want to kind of satisfy our physical hunger, so we immediately jump up and go to the pantry or to the fridge or whatever, hop in the car and go get some fast food, because we want to satisfy them. Job says, this right here, I will treasure this more than any food that may be necessary. Brother Taylor, you come. Treasure. Loving God's Word. It develops a stabilized life, a constant heart, a constant life, a constant keeper. What I'm saying is this, is that in this section, I believe the psalmist has really just laid it all out there for us. That we should delight in God's Word. That we should have a deep love for God's Word, the greatest treasure. We should rejoice over it. We should have a constant, habitual praise life. That we don't just come in here on Sunday to praise, but even after we leave here, we're going to continue to praise God the rest of this day. All day long, we're going to praise and worship. We're going to obey the Word. believe the psalmist simply tells us that we're going to find that great peace. A great